Stefan, there's two people in front of the camera this time. Why am I not holding a microphone?
Because we hired a C-stand to do that for you.
Taking people's jobs.
You are here. We need two people to talk about this movie. Because technically this movie is two movies. But it's also the same movie. They did it twice.
So we're talking about the 1970 movie Equinox and also the Snyder Cut.
Release the Dennis Muren cut.
What we're actually talking about is a 1967 student film made by a bunch of film students who were really super into Ray Harryhausen and did it on a shoestring budget, which was impressive enough to a couple of distributors and producers that they decided to distribute the movie. By which I mean they took the special effects footage and essentially reshot all of the actual actor stuff. I mean, they got the same actors and it's...
Right.
Oh, what's the tape recorder for?
Listen. Okay, now, sit down here.
Let me go!
You better hold him down.
Cross, I gotta have that cross, please!
All right, David, we'll get you.
Just lower in a crucifix!
I got a call from Dr. Waterman.
Who is Dr. Waterman?
He was my geology professor.
So, in the original movie, we have a bunch of teenagers coming to...
Teenagers.
We have a bunch of teenagers played by 30-year-old men, but they're all coming to, I think in the original cut, visit a professor?
Well, in the original cut, they're going off on a double date for a picnic out in the woods. Hmm. And as you do on a double date, they're taking a detour to visit one of the guy's weird old professor friend who lives in a cabin in the middle of nowhere.
What happened?
I don't know.
An explosion?
As you do. In the theatrical cuts, they're specifically going to check on creepy old professor guy and are having a picnic along the way.
I took care of the beverage. Fresh mountain stream water. And I just hope you can cook chicken.
I'll have you know my chicken is of world renown.
Slightly less contrived.
Yeah, that makes a little more sense.
In a way that in and of itself is a microcosm of the difference between these two movies.
Right. Yeah, the 1971 definitely feels a bit more streamlined, I guess, than the original 60s cut.
See, I would use the word focused.
Focused, okay. Because like in both versions, on their way to the professor, they come across all these monsters and stuff, right?
Well, they very quickly stumble upon the miniature that's supposed to be the professor's cabin that has been completely smashed in.
Jim, wow, what happened?
Is that Dr. Waterman's cabin?
Explosion, stove or water heater maybe.
And for reasons that are never adequately explained, stumble their way into a cave with the really scary and mysterious cackling old man.
This movie was dubbed both times, right?
Yeah. Like... At no stage was this a production that was going to have live sound.
And in both versions, the old man is the most obviously dubbed over. And it's like the
It's the most obvious also because the guy on screen is just the old man from down the street who clearly is not an actor.
Yeah, but the voice he got was like this weird cartoony cackly old...
Now get out of here.
So yeah, basically he gives the teens the Necronomicon. And that's the plot.
And that's the plot. All these monsters come out of nowhere, literally, as we find out of nowhere, through like this rift in space where there's like a
this rift between the mats.
There's rift between the mats where like there's this whole other dimension with like demons and monsters and red filters and stuff like that.
We find out that Professor Guy, before the movie had even started, has unlocked the powers of the whatever and unleashed all of these monsters. And the rest of the movie, again, depending on which version you're looking at, is essentially our not Scooby-Doo gang running from the monsters, and that's the movie.
In the original cut, I think it was directed by Dennis Muren, the guy who would later on go and produce all the special effects for Star Wars.
Yeah, I believe he got bumped down to like a producer credit on the theatrical version. Even with the scenes that are just dialogue, the theatrical cut does reshoot a lot of those, but you can tell there was an attempt to insert more zingers in.
Davy boy, figure this one out, and our fortune is made in showbiz.
If you knew what was in that book, you'd turn to jelly.
I think what we're about to unearth is a practical joker who plants phony footprints, makes weird noises in caves to put people on.
Jenny's dead.
Are you sure?
And I just hope you can cook chicken.
I'll have you know my chicken is of world renown. Voila!
One of the major differences between these two movies is that the original cut, the threat is more the just the location being haunted, I guess.
I don't know. Look! The castle's gone!
I don't know if cosmic horror is the right word, but the bad guy is the entire realm that the monsters are coming from.
Right, right. Whereas in this one, there's definitely a overarching villain who ends up being Satan or something.
Yeah, the guy's name is Asmodeus, so you know he's totally trustworthy.
Asmodeus is another name for the devil.
The devil?
I believe it. You should have seen him in action.
But yeah, there's a much more obvious attempt to sort of focus all of the goings-on around a single personified antagonist character and to tie all of the disparate vignettes and set pieces through the... I was starting to use some really big flowery words that implies that they did more than just have a whole lot of scenes of one of the producers in a park ranger outfit standing next to trees looking really grim.
No.
And occasionally impersonating the guy at the beginning of Night of the Living Dead.
No.
Because that's all they actually did. Which sort of, again, speaks to the problem with the theatrical cut. You can tell the guys producing this thing knew more than the film student guys what an easily digestible mainstream movie ought to do.
Right.
That doesn't mean they knew how to do it. They knew what it ought to do. Right. And that's sort of the comparing and contrast between these two movies. I can imagine a whole lot of people preferring the student film version on the grounds of it being more interesting in the sense that it's much more abstract and weird. Mm. And accidentally taking advantage of how unfocused and scattershot its script is.
Right.
In such a way that it unintentionally evokes the very sensation of reality itself breaking down around the characters.
Forced on by a will equally as foreign to me, I gazed upon the other dimension. On this first of many journeys, I witnessed the migration of the dead to their eternal torture below.
Sort of like a lot of Italian horror movies and stuff like that. It's not really intentional, but they kind of fall backwards into it. Whereas the theatrical version is a much more straightforward, this is the bad guy is doing this stuff.
You better think fast, kid. Take my offer or you and your friends are as good as dead.
The student film version, I would say, is failing to do something so weird that there's not an obvious point of reference to it.
Right, right.
And really the most obvious points of reference are movies that hadn't even been made yet. Because we've danced around it, but really if you're gonna describe Equinox in either way, what your one-line elevator pitch is, what if Evil Dead had been made by somebody who liked Ray Harryhausen rather than the Three Stooges?
Right.
Because that's what it is.
Yeah, yeah.
A group of folks would go up to a cabin in the woods, find the Necronomicon, and then monsters happen. So we've compared and contrasted the two.
Mm-hmm.
If somebody really put you in the hot seat and you had to say, not which one is better, but which of the two versions of Equinox you like more, which would it be?
Because
I would have a really hard time answering
that. See, last year I just showed a group of people the original cut, and that was the first time I had ever seen it. But that's because it was the original cut, and I'm a snob like that. I like how there's a semblance of an arc in the new one, but I really like just the raw effort of a bunch of ragtag filmmakers in the original.
Let's put on a show.
Yeah, you know, like, let's put on a show. We're gonna have some giant monsters in it. It's gonna be great. Everyone's gonna love it. But you could really, I would argue, see some improvements in the theatrical cut. You know, Dennis Muren was interviewed actually for the Criterion release, and he said, you know, before he made this movie, he respected special effects creators like Ray Harryhausen, like Willis O'Brien from the 20s and 30s, all those guys. After he made the movie, he respected directors and writers more because they knew how to get people to stay in their seat. And I feel like some of that is on evidence when you contrast these two movies. Like, you know, there's a semblance of an arc in the new one, in the 70s theatrical cut. You know, there's a lot more to keep the viewer engaged than there was in the original cut, if that makes sense. But I don't know which I like more.
The very fact that the student film tries to avoid telling a more straightforward narrative story, so part of me, that's much more interesting than the more streamlined, straightforward movie.
Right.
But then, even for all of its hiccups, I definitely recognize that the theatrical version succeeds a lot more at taking all of its disparate parts and turning it into an actual working machine. So the question then becomes, am I more interested in the part of me that looks at the potential of the idea and what it could have been, or the part of me that's satisfied with what the end result actually was and how it came together? Oh. And that's that really depends just on what mood I'm in at the moment that I'm watching it.
Ah, which version would you show to somebody else to introduce them to it?
Well, that just depends on how weirded out the people you're showing it to would be by the scene with Asmodeus and Turtleneck Girl.
Oh, yeah.
Because that can be a make or break depending on who it is you're showing it to.
I'm not gonna lie, that was an aspect in my decision making when I decided to show it to people last year.
Credit where credit is due, there's a long, sad chain of exploitation filmmakers who use scenes like that exclusively for titillation and don't understand that they're still supposed to make it look as icky as it is. Whatever you want to say about our producers here, they knew to make that look as repulsive as possible. Drool coming off the set. That was not supposed to look sexy on any level. Okay, so I guess we're about out of stuff to say.
Yeah.
And I have a confession to make. When I'm over there holding the boom mic or whatever, I don't actually pay attention to these things. So I don't know what you do to end these. Like, is this video sponsored? Do we have to give like a plug to Nord Shadow Raycons or whatever?
No, we don't have a plug or anything like that. But the movie had a sponsor.
And I just hope you can cook chicken.
I'll have you know my chicken is of world renown. Voila!
Saved by the Colonel. Look at this. Yeah. Must be that pioneer stock in your background.
So yeah, fun facts to anybody who doesn't know about drive-in exploitation movies. If you made a low-budget drive-in exploitation movie, you were catered by the Colonel.
Yes, and not just catered, like, he paid for product placement. And would even do on-screen appearances at times, even.
How do you do?
How do, ma'am?
Hi.
Isn't that the most wonderful chicken you ever ate?
Hey, man. You serve fried chicken?
Do we serve fried chicken?
Well, really,
we do serve fried chicken.
Hey, boys, that was just fine.
Thank you.
Come back again anytime on the same deal.
Well,
I'll bring them back.
And cut.